Today, we're going to be talking about beginning witchcraft, 5 steps for starting your magical journey. This is Dr. John Michael Salvato, and this is part 2 of our series on beginning witchcraft. In our last installment, which I will link to in the About section below, we talked about connecting with the ancestors. Today, we're going to talk about the remaining 4 steps. More on that when we come back. Hey, welcome back. John Michael here, and you are watching Beginning Witchcraft, 5 Steps for Starting Your Magical Journey. Now, as you might recall from our previous installment, this is a program designed to kind of help you guys understand a little better the steps that somebody who's born into a magical family in the Italian folk magic tradition would go through as children. Beginning at the age of around 5 or 6 years old, we would learn stories, and those stories would gradually become more mature as we aged, and always sitting around the hearth or the fireplace, listening to these stories. In the summertime, listening to the stories out by a campfire, these stories would actually provide us with the fundamentals, the groundwork or foundation on which our magical practice would be built. So in our last installment, we talked about the importance of connecting with the ancestors. And I said that it was very important for you guys, before we take this next step, to get your hands on a copy of the Gospel of Aradia, or the Gospel of the Witches. And the reason for that is because all of these stories that we were being told were being told within the context of that mythos. Now, if you haven't already done so, I really encourage you to do that. This was kind of a test of your own seriousness, your own commitment to the craft. Because if you weren't willing to do those foundational steps, it might not be the right time for you to dive deeper into understanding the Italian folk magic tradition. And that's okay. Continue watching this video, because this is about beginning the craft. And we'll still share with you the 5 steps for starting your magical journey, because those will apply to any path you choose. So let's go ahead and dive in. As I said, step 1 is connect with the ancestors. That's going to give you sort of that grounding, an awareness of what your tradition is, so that we don't have to go down that road that so many people go into with cultural appropriation. And so it's one thing to explore various spiritual paths. It's another to take a tradition or a culture that's not your own and present yourself as a sort of an expert on that and go out there and monetize that. Those are manipulative and very violent things to do to other cultures. So when we connect with our ancestors, we find out that there's a richness there in our own heritage from which we can draw. The second step is know what magic is and what magic isn't. So what I mean when I say that is that a lot of people have the idea that magic is about worshiping the god and goddess. And you see posts and groups on Facebook that are all devoted to the various forms of the god and goddess, the horned god and Diana and Dianus and Serenos or Hecate, Kali, Shiva. But what we need to understand is that is religion. Religion is the worship and veneration of the god and the goddess in any of its forms. Magic has nothing to do with religion. Now, I know that's going to be controversial for some of you. I know that's going to be disappointing for those of you who think that what witchcraft is something similar to the Chilling Adventures of Sabrina, which I happen to love, or people who think that witchcraft is similar to Charmed or to Covenant or to any of the other films out there, like The Craft. You see, that's a representation of what witchcraft has been co-opted by in the 20th century. as Gerald Gardner and others misinterpreted what Charles Leland saw when he observed the covens, the Boschetto, in Italy, which was a religious group that came together and would worship the goddess Diana and her brother Dionysus, who together came together sexually and, as the story goes, gave us Aradia, the queen of the witches, the first witch. So, excuse me, that's why I wanted you to understand that story, so that you could see that that story really has nothing to do with witchcraft. It is the story, the backstory of Aradia. It is the a story of veneration of Diana and Dionysus, but it is not witchcraft per se. Now, I want you to think of this. Imagine going into a Catholic church or an Episcopalian church. In that church, on a Sunday, you may find priests, bishops, nuns, monks, but you're also going to find bakers, accountants, school teachers, librarians. See, when Charles Leland observed the Boschetti, the different covens or groves in Italy, what he was seeing was that quite often the people who presided over those gatherings, those religious gatherings, were indeed and in fact witches. But there were also people there who were the shoemakers and bakers and school teachers and accountants of those communities as well, because those people coming together were coming together for religion. They were coming together to worship. So when you go to a Catholic or an Episcopalian church, you might see priests and nuns and monks, but not everybody who's in that church is a priest or a nun or a monk. And so the act of being a priest, the act of being a monk, the act of being a nun is something separate and distinct from the place where people come to worship. It's a way of life. And then when people come to worship, people from all walks of life come together. And they worship the common god or goddess or combination thereof. And so that's why it's important to understand what magic is. Magic is not religious. It has never been religious. Magic is also not a form. Witchcraft isn't something that formed around women originally. In fact, the earliest known records and mention of witchcraft and witches referred to male witches, not female. Now, I'm not saying that there weren't female witches back in the time of the Code of Hammurabi. I'm simply saying that the earliest recorded mention of a witch in times long, long before the Common Era were mentions of male witches. So this notion, this fanciful idea that many of us were raised to believe, that witchcraft somehow surrounded the goddess and it was all about worshiping the goddess and her consort, the horned god. That's all the stuff of mythos. It's legend. And frankly, it's bullshit. Because witchcraft has always been. Magic has always been. The practice of being one with nature, using nature and energy. And really, at the end of the day, the only thing that a witch does is work with energy and bend it to his or her will. So understand what magic is and what magic isn't. That was one of the very first things after learning the story of Aradia that my matriarch and my grandmother taught me, was understanding the difference between magic and the old religion, between witchcraft and the old religion. And then learn the terminology. That's step three. We say learn the terminology because in every single part of the craft, there are going to be terms that are used that might be unique, not only unique in use to that particular form of the craft, but maybe unique in the way that they're interpreted. For example, one of the religions that arose in the 20th century, one of the first times that we've heard this story, this legend about witchcraft being something that surrounds and arose out of the worship of the goddess Diana by any of her names, and her brother Dionysus by any of his names. then that's the stuff of religion, but it's a religion that attracts in the 20th century many witches. And so the idea in Wicca of things like the Wiccan reed and the law of three and other such things that are absolutely constructs of the people who created that religion. And they created that religion in the 20th century. It has never existed before. There's nothing that even remotely resembled Wicca in the ancient world, other than the cult of Diana, the cult of the goddess and the god, which was not witchcraft. So to Wiccan practitioners, witchcraft and Wicca might be one and the same, depending on their particular sect and their particular interpretation. So we have to learn the terminology. So for our terminology in the Italian folk magic tradition, when we talk about witchcraft, we're talking about magic, about the craft of the wise, the unnamed and crooked path. And when we talk about the old religion, we might call that La Vecchia, or we might call it La Vecchia Religione. The old religion, that is a religion. That's the part that's kind of similar to what the Wiccan community does. And I want to be really clear. I have nothing but respect for any and all of the religious traditions that arose out of pagan spirituality. So I will defend anyone's right to be Wiccan or to practice stregheria. It's another religion that was created in the 20th century. It's basically Wicca with Italian seasoning, an Italian cultural tradition. But none of these things were ancient practices. And so we just have to be able to recognize and deal with the facts and then show respect for those traditions, because they can be beautiful traditions, very rich liturgical traditions. And so we learn what the terminology means. And it's important to be able to do that. When we know what the terminology means, it's easier for us then to move forward and be on the same page. Step four is to find a mentor. Now, that mentor may be somebody who is a teacher in the tradition that you wish to follow. It may also be somebody from outside traditions, so that you get a good grounding, you get a sense of what's out there and what various expressions of magical philosophy looks like. And as I said, maybe even some of those who've created magical religions in the 20th century, so that you understand those paths, because you're going to cross paths with people from various traditions. None of us lives in a vacuum. And the most important thing that you can do, step five, is to engage your practice. So whatever it is that you feel drawn to or called to, whatever that expression of your magical self happens to be, engage it. Don't just be an armchair witch or an armchair wizard or sorcerer or practitioner by whatever name you choose to call yourself, but engage that practice. Even if it's spending 15 minutes every day, do something every single day to engage your practice and allow that practice to unfold organically. You see, these five steps: connect with the ancestors, know what magic is and isn't, learn the terminology, find a mentor, and engage your practice. These are the foundations of building a practice that will actually develop you. Don't just develop your practice, but you allow the work that you do to make something of you, not just for you. And I promise, if you follow those five simple steps, the result will be magnificent, and it will be magical, and it will be an adventure to last a lifetime. So these are the five steps that I really want you to take some time as we get closer to Samhain. And we begin this class that's going to dig deeper and dive deeply into stregoneria, the Italian folk magic tradition, in all of its ancient forms. You're going to begin to recognize why I say connect with the ancestors and why that's so much a part of what we do, to know what magic is and isn't, because you don't want to get caught up in the practice of the religion the vecchia religione when you're trying to cultivate magical skills, because the two don't have anything really to do with one another. Learn the terminology throughout the practice and throughout the sort of mini course that we're going to do. I'm going to teach you some of the terminology that matters. That's why I really recommend it, that if you haven't done so, you consider getting your hands on a copy of my book, Magic at the Crossroads, because there's a really good glossary of terms in there. Find a mentor. I'm more than happy to share the information and wisdom that's been given to me. Now, I will tell you that in our tradition, it is our custom, and it is a custom that I intend to keep to, that we don't share what's called the secrets with the outside world. In fact, we're not permitted to teach until we're 50 or older. But what I'm going to do, because I find that we live in a world where these lines drawn in the sand too often just end up creating barriers between people. And there is so much richness in the Stregoneria tradition, in the ancient craft of the wise, that I can't keep it just for my family. And so I'm going to teach those things in a way that's accessible to you, in a way that's adaptable for you, and that's still respectful of my culture and my tradition and of the codes of secrecy. Because those secrets are for very good and very important purposes. But I can teach you the fundamentals. I can teach you how to open that door and allow you to go deeper and to cultivate a practice that will be genuinely yours. So it doesn't matter if you're Italian or not. As long as you follow the practice that I offer you and don't co-opt it. Don't try to learn everything. You're not going to learn everything that I know in this class. You're going to learn all the things that I feel it's right to teach someone. And in that process, once you've learned those fundamentals, you'll be able to engage with a mentor and find somebody that may be me or it may be someone else that you resonate with, and begin to more deeply engage your practice until you find your magical path. Because what I'm going to share with you is my magical path. I don't have all the answers. I don't know all the secrets, and I don't know all the answers to all the secrets. But what I know is that this has been a part of my life for the last 50 years, and it's been an incredible part of my life. And so I want to share that with you and give you the opportunity to deepen your practice, especially if you're Italian, though, because this is our culture. This is the story of our people, of our ancestors. And so I'm going to go as deeply as I can. And with those of you who come from Italian backgrounds, if you want to go deeper when this course is over, then we can talk about that. So until next time, this is probably going to be the last of these segments that I do prior to Samhain, which is in the first week of November. And of course, in our tradition, it isn't Samhain. But we're going to share with you in the right course and right time and in the right context. And the reason that I'm choosing to do it at that time, and you'll understand better when I do that first class, is because the very first thing we're going to do is going to be to connect with our ancestors, to understand how to begin bringing that reverence every single day. I think I might actually do one more class, and that will be the precursor. It'll still be officially lesson one, but it's going to be the precursor, which allows you to take a few steps so that when we begin, you're able to begin with a connection to the ancestors. And we're going to talk more about that in the next class. I try to keep these things to 20 minutes, and I think I might have done that again tonight. If not, I apologize for keeping a minute or two over. Stay in the moment. Be grateful for what you've got. That gratefulness for what you have opens the door for more to come in. And if you can't be grateful for what you've got, there's no reason to think you're going to be any happier with more. And always remember, the best is yet to come. We'll talk to you soon.